Good day, everyone. This is one of the four presentations of the session Customary Water Tenure, a Commons Lens Filling the Voids in the Water Sector. Customary Water Tenure regards the ways in which indigenous peoples and local communities relate to each other with regard to water, so within their communities and between communities and outsiders. This has largely remained invisible. One of the reasons is that water tenure is integrated. But this integration seeps away between the silos of specialist academia in the water sector, but also in customary land, forest, and other resource tenure, and also in policies and laws. This session adopts a holistic commons lens to fill these voids. And my presentation now is on living customary water tenure, presenting evidence from literature and fieldwork, and conceptualizing, as far as possible, this holistic, integrated nature as found on the ground, and with a focus on rural sub-Saharan Africa. These realities of widespread practices and norms give some further content to customary water tenure, for which Jessica Trowell, in her presentation, traces their recognition and protection in national resource and other legislation, including constitutional and human rights frameworks. Patience Mukuyu focuses on the concrete example of South Africa, which is grappling precisely with the issue of legal recognition of customary land and water tenure. Every villager in Africa, whom I asked, who owns water, answered, water is given by God. And without going into the profound cosmological meanings, the question here is, does that imply that water resources are open access for grab by everyone? Does Harding's tragedy of the commons hold? This is a real risk, as in the well-documented land and water grabs by powerful outsiders, such as Coca-Cola, other beverage industries, or plantations of irrigated flour and beans for export. And South Africa's apartheid, water development and laws already did precisely that. In living customary water tenure, in contrast, water is not for grab, but a common good with rules and norms for sharing. And as this Boran saying goes, the own clan settled in a territory or set out pastoral routes with their land-bound water sources, rivers, lakes, wetlands, or groundwater. And it has internal rules for the sharing of those sources internally, but also seeks to signify respect to outsiders, which clearly differs from water grabs. Interestingly, the last decades or so, the interest of governments, NGOs, and academia in rural communities' own ways to deal with water grew. Both the wash sector, which focuses on domestic water uses, and the irrigation sector saw how more and more people, whether individually or self-organized subgroups, sometimes an entire community, invest in their own infrastructure for so-called self-supply. Technologies and energy sources become cheaper, populations and their aspirations grow, and there are markets to pay water vendors or sell irrigated produce. In the water sector, Sally Sutton wrote a book, and the World Bank, for example, adopted a guide for farmer-led irrigation development, as self-supply is called in the irrigation sector. So support to self-supply has emerged as a complementary approach to the sector's conventional approaches, in which states or other outsiders finance and construct public infrastructure and may partially subsidize, operate, and maintain and replace the assets as well. And this role of infrastructure is unique for water tenure. As any rural woman knows, access to water and water security depends on two things. First, access to nearby natural water resources, and second, having the infrastructure for storage and conveyance. So drums, tanks, and dams store water when there is too much for use later. So more water becomes available for secure human use. And storage is only becoming more important in the climate change, with higher and less predictable variability and more extreme droughts. And for water conveyance, there are the lightweight buckets carried by foot, but also the pipes, canals, or groundwater pumps to bring water to the site of use, so homesteads, distant fields, or other sites of use. So water resources are to be shared. However, claims to water that has been stored and conveyed by one's individual or collective infrastructure, those claims are strong, or as Coward calls it, hydraulic property. But of course, without the natural resources to fill or feed into the infrastructure, it runs dry. This growing interest by the wash and the irrigation sectors remained largely locked in the silos of infrastructure for the single use of their mandates, even though both sectors deal with the same communities, same water resources, and technically the same type of energy source and infrastructure. For single-use sectors, integrated water tenure is still too complex. And this is very different for communities. As some of you would know, in one morning, communities can map their spatial layout of houses, fields, grazing lands, and forests, their different natural water resources, and each piece of infrastructure that are financed by government as public infrastructure or their own self-supply. And all pieces of old, partly dilapidated, refurbished, and new infrastructure may even look like spaghettis. On these pictures, on the slide, such mapping served as the participatory diagnostic step for community-led planning and design of water services for multiple users. In this approach, communities identify and prioritize next incremental improvements with support provided by outsiders. And in a separate presentation, I can tell how this stepwise planning process evolved after this diagnostic step, as we applied in 6 villages in South Africa. But moving here now to the more generic features, communities have managed this complexity as a matter of daily life, if not survival since time immemorial. As people need water for domestic and productive uses, certainly in rural areas, they use infrastructure for multiple purposes, and especially at and around homesteads. And they have usually access to multiple naturally available surface and groundwater sources. In many parts of sub-Saharan Africa, water resources are abundant and they are open access. Territorial settlement and spatial layout was shaped by water availability for direct use and over time more and more infrastructure. And communities welcome their members' opportunity to improve their livelihoods with infrastructure. Negotiation is about preferences among the multiple sources and the range of infrastructure design options. A harsh zero-sum game of stiff competition is typically confined to dry seasons. However, with continuing abstractions by more people, the preferences gradually evolve into competition for limited sources and during longer periods or year-round. With deeper pumps, investors, typically the wealthier, seek to win the race to the bottom of the aquifers. And in a race to the top of mountainous streams, the more upstream sites are preferred. We found cases in which people were keen to take up all the efforts of abstracting water from these streams, but seeking some guarantee that the source would remain available to them as the first comers, they asked for approval from the traditional authority. And this evidence was successfully used against a new river abstractor who wanted to put his intake and pipes even further upstream. He lost. In these and other cases of growing competition, customary authority structures appear to be key for nested conflict mediation. But yes, infrastructure ownership is expensive and the relative inequalities may increase. At the same time, we find that there's a clear moral duty to share water, also water from the own infrastructure, because refusing access to water would give more problems to the community. And without going deeper here, inequalities also widen along gender lines. Male monopolization of infrastructure compounds weak land rights and decision making. And it will take long before all women can meet their water needs with 24/7, year-round functioning infrastructure, preferably the state. But when it comes to sharing water with outsiders, community members, men, women, rich and poor, have the same interests. And outsiders might impact on, or are impacted by, shared gravity streams, aquifers, or lakes. Or outsiders enter the village seeking to access water resources for direct use, or for putting their pipes and pumps. Between neighboring communities, customary arrangements along rivers developed. It's very well analyzed, for example, by Hans Komakec for the Pangani Basin in Tanzania. Or, and what brings us back to the risk of water grabs by powerful third parties, outsiders can bluntly enter communities, territories, and put their pipes or pumps. And especially when land tenure is not so clearly defined. For example, in the forest, high up in the mountains, where the water towers are. Due process for free, participatory and informed consent between the third parties and the community during the planning of these infrastructures is key. So to conclude, what can we learn from this commons lens on customary water tenure? Which voids are filled? Well, water tenure is part and parcel of customary resource tenure in general. It's flexible socio-territorial rights to various water sources for sharing within and even outside communities. Engineering and water resource rights intersect. Investments in infrastructure alter water resource availability more than anything else. This can be positive. Storage improves availability when it matters most. However, growing competition for preferred water sources has winners and losers. And the key moment to negotiate these changing claims to water resources, especially with outsiders, is during infrastructure planning. Once constructed, the new owners of infrastructure can claim first come, first in rights to the water resource and even stronger rights to water stored and conveyed. So in the next challenge to integrate communities, water sectors and states, customary water tenure should be recognized as starting point. And the core minimum that especially states should guarantee would be enough for all forever. Thank you.